Fernandez, I'm pleased to provide you with this movie that I produced of my trip to Italy in December 2015 with my friend Lena. I blurred her face out in the video because she's a private person. She works in government and she does not want her identity disclosed to the public, so I've done her a favor and blurred her face. I've taken basically approximately 2,000 pictures and mixed them into a movie with classical music, Beethoven and Mozart, different selections. And the movie pretty much speaks for itself, so I'm not going to basically have my voiceovers to a minimum, and I'm going to basically have little titles below what you're looking at to a minimum, so you could just enjoy the pictures with the music. And it's something that goes on for approximately 2 hours, and there are a few little scrolling commercial segments that hopefully won't interfere with the movie, but obviously we got to pay for this somehow. But other than that, I will pop on in just a few parts of the movie to let you know what's going on. So here in the beginning, you're seeing Vatican City, Rome, the Papal Center. It's basically a separate country within Italy where the Pope sits. It's the center of the Catholic Church, and although many of you might not be Catholic, including me, it is just majestic to see not only the architecture of the Vatican but the art that they've accumulated throughout their museum. I'd like to go back and spend maybe a month just exploring the museums of Rome. So without further ado, enjoy the movie.
Thank you.
Hello again. What you're seeing now is the view as you exit the Vatican Museum to enter another portion of the museum. This square is awesome. That's the only thing I can say about it. As you can see, the art and the architecture coupled with the way it's laid out is just phenomenal. You can see the Roman statues, which are ancient. These particular statues are over 1,000 years old, and it's just awe-inspiring. This is the type of view that you can actually just sit there for hours and, you know, kick back. It's a place where you'd like to take a picnic and have a picnic. And then, as you can see in this room, there's literally hundreds of statues. And if you look closely at the statues, back in ancient times, they didn't have photography. So this was their way of capturing people. They used paint and sculpture to capture the likeness of people. Whereas we today have photography. And so when you look at the faces, these look like people you might know today. However, these sculptures are, you know, over 1,000 years old, which is just amazing. Imagine if you could go back into time and, you know, meet these people. I'm sure that if you could speak the language, which in Roman times was Latin, I'm sure that they were just like people like you and me, except, you know, I could go into a great dialogue with respect to how the Romans were, their republic, their slave society, their blood games, and so forth. But that's not the purpose of this video. So just enjoy the statues and the view. And by the way, if I didn't tell you before, I took approximately 2,000 pictures on this trip. I'm an amateur photographer with primitive equipment. I didn't even use an SLR camera. I used a point-and-click camera, but I'm prolific. And my travel partner, I think, got a little bit upset at me because I was taking my time. As you can see, each one of these views is an actual picture that I took. A few of the pictures, obviously, my travel partner took a picture of me maybe from a distance, but for the most part, every picture was manually taken by me in this movie. Not only that, but I manually mixed this movie myself, so who knows, maybe somebody out there in Hollywood land would like my services. So take care and enjoy the rest of the movie. So here is an interesting view. The stairs behind me and the stairs in the next picture are the back entrance to the Sistine Chapel. And real quickly, the story goes is we went into the Sistine Chapel, and obviously that's where Michelangelo painted his masterpieces on the ceiling. Unfortunately, I did try to get pictures in there, but I was immediately rebuffed by the security. They do not want you taking pictures inside, video or pictures. And I'm sure that in most of the museums in Italy, you're not allowed to use any flash whatsoever because the flash apparently will damage the paintings. But so the reason you see nobody there is because we walked out the wrong door. We ended up going down those stairs, and that's the back entrance to the Sistine Chapel. And so I took a picture of myself standing there. Not only that, but the stairs by themselves and the ornate ceiling of the hallway next to the Sistine Chapel. You can just imagine the history. I mean, who actually walked those stairs? And I'm sure Michelangelo himself, the famous artist who painted the Sistine Chapel, walked those stairs. And by the way, the Sistine Chapel was Michelangelo's first painting attempt. Before that time, he was just a sculptor. That's another story altogether. So from there, because we walked out the wrong door, we opened another door and we ended up in St. Peter's Basilica. We actually did purchase tour tickets to tour St. Peter's Basilica, and we were planning on going into St. Peter's Basilica after, you know, touring the Vatican Museum. But because we took the wrong door, we actually walked right into it. And as a matter of fact, the area where we walked, there was no security, there was no barriers, so we were able to walk all through the Sistine Chapel with minimal people with us and basically see it like nobody else has seen it. They actually had a boys choir singing in the background, and I did get some video of that, but this type of movie that I'm doing here, I don't put actual video. It's actual still pictures that are moving like pictures. But the boys, the actual boys choir that sings during the Pope's services at St. Peter's Basilica was practicing while we were in there. We spent a lot of time. It's a huge building. It's just amazing, the building. The amount of money that was put into the art and to the building, it's quite obvious that they're trying to, the Catholic religion and the people who control the Catholic religion are trying to impress people and showing people that, hey, they're special. I mean, because the kind of wealth that's displayed within the Sistine Chapel is just, to be quite frank, unrivaled anywhere on earth. I mean, gold leaf, just the ornateness of it. You know, I'm sure that people back in the day, before TV, before motion pictures, would look at something like this and just, you know, believe that God has something to do with this. So that's a whole other story as well. Bottom line, the architecture, the art, I've never seen anything like it before in my entire life, and I definitely need to go back. For if you are an art lover, Italy is definitely a place you need to be. So without further ado, enjoy the rest of the recording. Actually parked our rental car here, and due to the fact that I did get a rental car, we actually were forced to walk from our parking space to, you know, like places like the Colosseum and stuff, so we actually got to see much more than, let's say, had we just took a tour bus. So the interesting thing about the Jewish ghetto is that it didn't seem like I met any Jewish people there. It looks like the entire place was wiped out in World War II by the Nazis, and you know, who took over, you know, Germany, who occupied Germany after Italy basically capitulated to the Allies during World War II. So the Jewish ghetto, you know, we had dinner there. They have shops that sell Jewish paraphernalia there. The dinner was excellent, by the way. We found a square with just hugely ornate statues and architecture and so forth. But everybody I asked, hey, are you Jewish? They're all, no, we're not Jewish. So it appears that the Jews were all wiped out during World War II. And just so you know, I am Jewish. Enjoy the rest of the movie.
Thank you.
you can see from the previous pictures, is just awe-inspiring. The walk through the Forum on the way to the Roman Colosseum. The Roman Colosseum is probably one of the most, if not the world's most famous tourist attraction. It dates back well over 1,000 years, and it's a place where the Romans put on multiple different events. It was obviously the center of their entertainment world. They did not have TV, they did not have Ultimate Fighting. They had the Circus Maximus, and they had places like the Forum, where basically not only did gladiators fight in duels to the death, but they also had, you know, mock naval battles where they actually filled it with water and had naval battles. They would actually have wild animals eat Christians alive. They would do executions, and for the Romans, this was entertainment. And, you know, it's hard to imagine what life was like back then, but in Roman society, there were a lot of slaves that controlled most, they didn't control Rome, but they basically provided all the labor for Rome. And so basically Rome, many of the Roman citizens did not have jobs, did not have money, did not have food. So actually the Roman government would provide bread to the people who attended the Colosseum Games. And it was basically a way for the Roman government to control the population. It's a very interesting thing. And, you know, the thing that's analogous to the Roman Colosseum now is, you know, TV and boxing and UFC. We have blood sports now, too. I mean, we're not watching guys fight to the death, but we have football. We have very violent sports, boxing. And, you know, so the Romans, they watched these fights, and they were entertained. It was a way for the Caesar, the emperor, to control the population. So as we see pictures of the Forum, they actually have built part of the platform up there. You can see it there, just to show you what it may have looked like back in ancient times. Obviously, this is a ruin, thousands of years old. You know, throughout the years, people of Rome have taken bricks and building materials from this building, you know, to use. But in its heyday, this thing was awesome. And only God knows how many people were killed inside this arena. It's hard to imagine when you look at it, but this was a place of death and entertainment. And if you look at the bottom of the Colosseum, you'll see where not only the gladiators, but the slaves, the people that were condemned to death, they would be basically locked underneath the platform there, waiting for their time to come up. They basically had trap doors with pulleys and a conveyor system to rise you up to the playing level, and they would do what they would to you. And you can imagine in ancient times a building like this. I mean, most of the rest of the world were just completely backwards. Like the Gauls, which are the Germanic tribes, they were basically, you know, living in the forest in huts. You know, you had Jerusalem, you know, to the east, and, you know, Jerusalem was pretty, you know, advanced as a society, you know, the Jewish society there that Rome actually put under their thumb. But for its architecture, for its, you know, plumbing, for its aqueducts, its art, Rome was highly advanced. And so you can imagine when people came from places like Africa, even Egypt, that was, you know, advanced, when they came to Rome and saw these buildings, they were just awestruck. So anyway, with respect to the Colosseum and the rest of this movie, enjoy. Take care. Thank you.
Thank you.
the city of Florence, Italy, which is the Tuscany region of Italy. Florence, Italy is the birthplace of the Renaissance, and that's a big deal for Western European history. Prior to the Renaissance, we had what we call the Dark Ages, which was the time between the fall of the main Roman Empire, which actually moved from Rome to Constantinople, which is now Istanbul, Turkey. That was called the Byzantine Empire, but it was actually when the Roman Empire split into two, where you had one emperor in Rome and one emperor in Constantinople. And unfortunately, the empire in Rome was sacked numerous times by different peoples, such as the Vandals, which destroyed Rome to such an extent that coined the term Vandalize. You had the Gauls, you had Attila the Hun, you had various pagan tribes that basically sacked Rome and destroyed Rome. You had the rise of Christianity, and Emperor Constantine from Rome adopted the Christian religion. A lot of people think that he did that in order to, bolster his empire. They don't really think he believed in the religion, but that's debatable, and that's not my area of expertise. But the point is, there was a point when the Roman Empire fell and Christianity basically took over, where you had basically a lot of shenanigans going on throughout Europe. There was actually a pope in France at one point, and then there was a pope in Rome, and basically they did a lot of things to try to control Europe. The church became all-powerful, and through the Inquisitions, which was basically where people would be tortured if they were accused of witchcraft or not following the church doctrine, and killed. They'd be burned at the stake, they'd be executed in horrendous ways, tortured, and further you had the bubonic plague, which, from what I understand, destroyed, I think, three-quarters of the population of Europe during the Dark Ages. So, with the advances of the Roman Empire, with bathing, with medicine and so forth, we actually, in our Western human history, went backwards during the Dark Ages of Christianity. Obviously, minority religions such as the Jewish people and others were persecuted through the Dark Ages. And then you had Pope Innocent I and other popes started the Crusades. And so basically, Florence, Italy is where the Renaissance occurred. That's where people, enlightened people, I guess today you would call them liberals, where they basically rebelled against the church, and they started doing things that the church did not like, which, they had basically avant-garde art, medicine, and the church actually allowed them to do these things. And so that's why they call it the Renaissance. I basically call it freedom. You actually had liberal freedom, and it's so limited compared to what we have today, but this was the beginning of the modern age, the Renaissance. So this particular city, Florence, is the birthplace of the Renaissance, and the art in this city. Just let me tell you something. When you walk into the center of Florence and you see the square, you see the exquisite sculptures and the exquisite architecture and the ornate decorations of the buildings. You see the Uffizi Gallery, you see the art and the immense wealth. It's just incredible. There's no way that words can possibly describe the true grandeur of Florence. When I saw Florence for the first time, I actually wanted to stay for a couple weeks or even a month. I even could potentially live there for 6 months to a year, you know, because basically this is a significant place in human history. Now, in America, you know, we're new world, new wealth. Yes, we have extravagant buildings in New York, San Francisco, Los Angeles, but nothing on the scale of what they have in Europe, especially Florence. So if there's any place, you know, you possibly would want to go in Europe, you definitely have to check out Florence. I would say Florence is more important than Rome and Venice or any of the other European capitals combined. Now, that's debatable. Obviously, you know, England was a great power back in the day. They were like a world superpower. So they have immense wealth there and immense architecture and buildings as well. But just the ornateness, and if you take a look at these pictures, just the detail in the, not only the art, but, you know, the tapestries, the ceilings, it's just, there's no way a picture will do it justice. You must see this in person. And my travel companion, well, she's European, you know, she taught me a few things while I was there, but she mostly liked to run through the museums. Actually, she was way ahead of me, mostly because I like to take pictures of everything. But she kind of got a little upset at me because I wanted to go real slow. And we were on a schedule. We had a tight schedule, 2 days in Florence, and it definitely was not enough. And I will tell you this, we were there, I think, a week before Christmas. So there's Christmas trees, Christmas decorations. And of course, Italy is a Catholic country, so Christmas was a major deal. And bottom line is that it was very cold, too. Rome was chilly. Florence was much more colder, obviously, because it's more north. And then Venice was even freezing, I mean, freezing cold, you know. But so everybody's walking around in their winter clothes. I'm a Southern California boy, so I'm not used to running around freezing in winter clothes. It was just a romantic time to be there. If there's any time for you to go to Italy, I strongly suggest going in December. The reason being is because you're going to see all the Christmas decorations up, and none of the tourists are going to be there. It's going to be very empty compared to, let's say, the summer. I'm sure this place is just packed during the summer. I do not like packed places. So it was crowded, but it was not even close to being as busy as it will be in the summer. So that when you go to places like the Uffizi Museum, or you go to the Academy of Arts to see the Michelangelo statue, you know, basically it's not packed, so you can actually walk around and take pictures like I did, as you can see in this video here. So without more ado, enjoy what you're seeing here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we find ourselves in Venice, Italy. This city is an iconic city. I'm sure you've all seen the pictures of the canals and the boats that go through the canals. They say that you cannot travel throughout Venice without taking the gondola, which in modern times, you know, is a very expensive proposition. It's a tourist attraction, basically. But the history of Venice is quite interesting. Basically, you had a people who basically moved into the swamplands, which is Venice, modern-day Venice. You know, it's basically out into the water where there was some land, you know, but it's basically, you have to go through swampland, and there was only, like, one way to get through there. And these people were trying to escape all the Germanic tribes from the north that were coming in and raiding Rome and Italy, basically. So you had these basically pagan tribes and, you know, barbarians coming in from the north raiding constantly. So the people that founded Venice were doing so just to be able to survive. They wanted to hide out somewhere where they would not be found, and in a place that would be inaccessible to the barbarians. So that's how Venice got its start. And eventually, you know, Venice, it became a, you know, waterborne system there, because the only way to get around was on water. The only way to get into the place was with boats. So eventually it became a huge trading center in the Italian scheme of things. It was actually its own city-state, you know, until everything got integrated. And the people of Venice eventually became very, very wealthy. Let me tell you something. Rome is beautiful. Rome's got beautiful cities. Excuse me, not cities, but beautiful buildings, beautiful art. Florence has beautiful art, ornate, and so forth. But my goodness, the inside of some of these palaces, especially Doge's Palace, are just unbelievable. I mean, if you look at the pictures, you'll take a look and see the art on every wall, including all the ceilings and so forth. And it's just incredible wealth. Venice was also famous back in the day for a little bit of partying. They would have their costume balls, which they still have today, and everybody would get dressed up and go to these things. And, you know, obviously not everybody in the city was rich. My travel companion and I, something I like to do is always walk the back streets to see what the real town is like outside of the tourist part of it. And, you know, we walk the back streets of Venice, and to be quite frank, it doesn't look too, you know, pleasing. It looks like, you know, just your lower rung type of apartments. But when you go to the tourist areas, everything looks nice. Another thing Venice is known for is it's like a maze. I mean, literally, we had a beautiful hotel, but it was, like, so difficult to find. Luckily, my travel companion, she was like one of those sniffer dogs. She could find the hotel no matter where we were, because I'll tell you what, if I didn't have her with me, there's no way I would have found that hotel. I mean, it is like a maze, basically. You're walking like a rat maze, and little, you know, travel ways. There's hundreds of bridges and so forth, but it's just a very interesting place. Another interesting thing is there are no cars allowed in Venice. There are no motor transport. So here I had a lot of luggage, and you have to carry your luggage to the hotel because there's no way to transport it. So basically, there we were. She had a small bag. She was laughing at me because I brought two pieces of luggage. She brought one, and I'm sitting there. It was just a pretty big struggle going through Venice, because you got to then lift these things over, you know, the stairs, you know, over the canals. Basically, they have these little bridges with stairs that you'll see in the pictures. I tried to find somebody to hire, and it's just not gonna work. So I don't care if you're a super rich guy, which I'm not saying I am. But if you have even 100, you know, euros to pay somebody to lift your luggage, good luck. I tried, believe me. So we're lugging our stuff through the town, and we weren't the only ones. I mean, there's people every minute that we were there lugging luggage, you know. So Once you get into the hotel, once you're packed up, it's basically a big, huge shopping mall, but there are some beautiful places to see. The plaza there, Doge's Palace, there's a lot of different places to see in Venice. We only spent, a evening there. We got there in, we spent a day and a half there, basically, and it was butt cold. I mean, I'm gonna say it was probably in the 20s, maybe 20s, 30s. For a Southern California boy, that was untenable. For my travel partner, she's from Eastern Europe, so basically I'm sure she's used to the cold, but it was freezing, And so, another thing is she found some place, I think it was on Yelp or some application, some place to eat. I like to do sit-down dinners, especially when you're traveling to places like Italy. And that's another thing, by the way. In Europe, the food portion is not like it is here in America. So if you go to an Italian place and order spaghetti, they give you basically what we would consider to be like a side portion, almost like, how you get mashed potatoes in an American dinner? Well, that's the size of the portion they give you for spaghetti. So the portions are very small. It's not what you expect. In America, you expect when you get a spaghetti dinner, you expect a plate full of spaghetti, whereas they may give you a scoop of spaghetti. Also, the coffees in Italy are tiny, tiny little cups. And so I was always trying to find American coffee because I just like to have a big cup of coffee. I know their coffee is much stronger than ours in that little cup, but part of the joy of having a coffee is actually sipping on it for a while. So anyway, my travel partner found this place on Yelp. It turned out to be like they made homemade pasta there, and it was like a fast food pasta takeout place. So we had a little conflict because she really, really wanted that, so she ordered it. I mean, basically she was eating it like out of a Chinese box container. They have like the same kind of containers that the Chinese food comes in. She was eating it there because there was really no place to sit. And I just thought, this is kind of ridiculous. This is what I'm thinking in my mind. This is kind of ridiculous, that you come all the way to Venice, Italy to eat like that. So I insisted upon going to a sit-down meal. And this was the first night we were there. So I went to this restaurant, and so I could tell she was a little upset because here I'm getting a full-on meal, whereas she had this basically like a Chinese thing full of pasta, basically. And I ended up ordering beef tartare. I couldn't understand anything on the menu. I just ordered, and it turned out to be raw meat, which was last time I had raw meat was in the military, and I didn't really enjoy that too much. That kind of turned me off a little bit. So, obviously another thing is in these hotels, they don't have American cable channels. So, and that's in all throughout Rome. It's all in Italian, just like you would expect, right? So thank God I had my tablet with me with Netflix, so I was able to get onto their Wi-Fi and watch Netflix movies through my tablet. Plus, I had saved up. I put some movies on there for the plane trip, too. So going back to Venice, it's just a place you got to go visit. My friend, she says, it's a place that there's really nothing to do. Maybe it's a 1 or 2 day thing and that's it. But I disagree. I could probably spend, a month or 2 months in Venice as well. It's just a different lifestyle there, a different way of being. And it's a different ambiance. And, if I could, I would retire right now and I would just travel Europe maybe half of the year, And then the other half of the year, I would travel in my motorhome throughout the United States. That's what I would do. But so anyway, I've got a little verbose here. I want you to enjoy the rest of the video. This will be the last narration that I'm doing here in the movie. And at the end of the movie, the very end of the movie, you will see just some mixed in pictures that were taken with my cell phone that I couldn't artfully fit into the rest of the movie. Plus, you'll see Doge's Palace. You'll see just a vast array of military armory, which I'm obviously interested in as a United States Air Force veteran. You'll see basically the history of warfare, ancient warfare, through Doge's Palace. You'll see spears, you'll see archery, bows and arrows, you'll see crossbows, you'll see swords, pikes, malices, maces, guns, flintlocks, matchlocks, and I got pictures of everything. So go ahead and enjoy. Thank you for watching my video, and please look for more videos in the future because I do enjoy creating these videos. They do take a long time. I sure wish I had the resources of a post-production company to help me, but unfortunately I don't have that right now. But anyway, this is Attorney Norman Gregory Fernandez. I'm a California personal injury attorney. If God forbid you have a personal injury anywhere in the state of California, give me a call at 800-816-1529. My website is thepersonalinjury.com, thepersonalinjury.com. If you need me, you can reach me, and you can also contact me through the YouTube channel that has this video. Take care, and enjoy the rest of the movie.
Thank you. Thank you.